السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته، أهلا وسهلا بكم طلاب وطالبات الفرقة الثالثة بكلية الطب في محاضرة جديدة من محاضرات النيورو أناتومي. المحاضرات السابقة we discussed in details these two pictures which are representing the horizontal section of the brain on the right side and the coronal section of the brain on the left side. And it is very important now to identify all the details of these two sections. And try to test yourself by solving these three simple MCQs. Today we will discuss an important structure in the function of the brain, which is the little brain or the cerebellum. The cerebellum is situated in the posterior cranial fossa, in what's called infratentorial space. It is separated from the cerebrum above by the tentorium cerebelli. The tentorium cerebelli is a fold of dura mater that separates between the cerebrum above and the cerebellum below. The cerebellum is consisting of right and left cerebellar hemispheres, which are connected through the midline vermis. And it's the cerebellum has two surfaces, superior surface and inferior surface. As you can see, this is the superior surface and this is the inferior surface. On the superior surface, we have two notches. This is the anterior notch of the cerebellum and the posterior notch of the cerebellum. The anterior notch is called the midbrain notch because it is occupied by the midbrain. The midbrain is the first part of the brain stem, and here in the anterior notch, it's connected to the midbrain through the superior cerebellar peduncle, as we will see in the following slides. So the anterior notch is lodged by the first structure in the brain stem, which is the midbrain. The posterior notch is called valicula, and it's lodged by the falx cerebelli. It is another fold of dura, which separates between the right and the left cerebellar hemisphere. In the cerebellum, we have these longitudinal folds, which are called the folia. These folia are representing the smallest unit of the cerebellum. The cerebellum has so many folia, and they are separated like lobules inside each lobe of the cerebellum. We have three very important anatomical fissures that separates the cerebellum into three important lobes. We have the primary fissure. This is the primary fissure, which is present on the superior surface of the cerebellum. It separates between the anterior lobe and the posterior lobes of the cerebellum, or between the anterior one-third and posterior two-thirds of the cerebellum. We have another fissure, which is called the horizontal fissure. This fissure begins at the anterior notch from the site of attachment of the middle cerebellar peduncle between the pons and the cerebellum. And it encircles the whole substance of the cerebellum, dividing the cerebellum into superior and inferior parts, and then end in the anterior notch again by joining the middle cerebellar peduncle on the other side. We have another very important fissure. It's just present on the inferior surface of the cerebellum. It's called posterolateral fissure. The posterolateral fissure separates between this small loop, which is present only on the inferior surface of the cerebellum, from the rest of the cerebellum. This small loop is called folliculonodular loop. This loop is very important in control the balance. So the folliculonodular loop is present on the inferior surface of the cerebellum and is separated from the rest of the cerebellum through the posterolateral fissure. Also on the inferior surface of the cerebellum, we have this structure, which is called cerebellar tonsil. Normally, the cerebellar tonsils are just in contact with the medulla oblongata around the foramen magnum, in the foramen magnum, but they are not descending in the foramen magnum. If they descend in the foramen magnum, this condition is called herniation of the cerebellar tonsil, and this is because of tumor or space inside this area, and this makes constriction or obstruction of the CSF, as we mentioned before, in the section of the ventricular system of the brain. So the tonsil or the cerebellar tonsil is separated from the inferior surface of the cerebellum by this fissure, which is called retrotonsillar fissure. So we have three main fissures: the primary fissure, the horizontal fissure, the posterolateral fissure, and we have also three main loops: the anterior loop, which is represented by the red color, in front of the primary fissure of the cerebellum. The green color is representing the posterior loop of the cerebellum, which is around two-thirds of the cerebellum. And also we have the folliculonodular loop, which is representing on the inferior surface of the cerebellum and separating from the rest of the cerebellum by the posterolateral fissure. If you look at the picture on the left side here, this picture representing the unfolded cerebellum. So if you unfolded cerebellum, so if you imagine that the cerebellum is like a circle and you unfold this circle from anterior to posterior side, so this will represent the horizontal fissure, and in front of the horizontal fissure, this will represent the anterior loop in front of the primary fissure. Here is the site of the primary fissure, and here this is the whole surface which comes in the inferior surface of the cerebellum. So the whole cerebellum is represented like a sheet of paper in front of you. You can see the whole details of the cerebellum and the whole loops of the cerebellum. So in front of the primary fissure, this is the anterior loop, and behind the primary fissure, this is the posterior loop, and here is the horizontal fissure, which divides the cerebellum into superior and inferior surface. You have to identify this important part of the cerebellum, which is called the vermis. So this represents the superior vermis, and this part here is representing the inferior vermis on the inferior surface of the cerebellum. The area just surrounds the vermis on the right and on the left side of the cerebellum is called paravermal region. So this area here is the paravermis on the right and on the left side of the cerebellum. And the rest of cerebellar hemisphere is represented by the green color. We have what's called deep cerebellar nuclei, which is embedded inside the substance of the cerebellum. If you remember, we have basal nuclei in the cerebrum. They control the motor activity. We have in the cerebellum another structure which is very important in the function of the cerebellum. They are called deep cerebellar nuclei. They are arranged from lateral to medial side. In this sentence, don't eat greasy food. So don't represent the dentate nucleus of the cerebellum, which is more lateral in position. Then the interposed nuclei. The interposed nuclei are the emboliform and globose nucleus. And then more medially, we have the vestigial nucleus, which is connected with the vermis. So you can easily predict that the vestigial nucleus is connected to the vermal region of the cerebellum, and the interposed nuclei are connected to the paravermal region of the cerebellum, and finally the dentate nucleus is connected to the lateral part of the cerebellum or the rest of the cerebellar hemisphere. If you take a sagittal section of the cerebellum, separating between the right and the left cerebellar hemisphere, you will see this picture. It's like a tree. So we are calling this picture the tree of life. The tree of life is representing the vermis of the cerebellum. Inside the vermis, you have a white matter. The white matter inside the vermis is representing the tracts that come and leave the cerebellum. They may come to the cerebellum from other structures like brainstem or spinal cord or cerebrum, and they leave the cerebellum through the peduncles, superior, middle, inferior cerebellar peduncles, and go to different structure, may be to the cerebrum above again and to the cerebellum below and the brainstem. Vertical subdivision of the cerebellum is very important. As we mentioned, the midline area here is called the vermis, and the area just surrounding the vermis is called the paravermis. You can easily see that the anterior loop, the body is represented on the anterior loop of the cerebellum in upside down manner, like the cerebrum. But you have to identify that the trunk area is represented on the vermis and the limb area are represented on the paravermal region. So the upper limbs and lower limbs are represented on the paravermal region, and the trunk area that controls the axial muscles are represented on the vermal region of the cerebellum. This is only on the anterior loop. On the inferior loop or in the posterior loop of the cerebellum, the body is represented in bilateral way, so that the trunk or the axial muscles are represented on the paravermal region more medially, and the distal limb muscles are represented on the paravermal region but more laterally. So the general rule is that the vermis is controlling the axial muscle, and the paravermal region of the cerebellum is controlling the distal muscles of the upper and the lower limbs. We have what's called cerebellar peduncles. You may know it before. The superior cerebellar peduncle is connecting between the back of midbrain and the cerebellum. The middle cerebellar peduncle is connecting the back of pons and cerebellum. And finally, the inferior cerebellar peduncle is connecting between the back of medulla oblongata and the cerebellum. And here you can identify the floor of the fourth ventricle between the back of pons and back of upper medulla and the cerebellum posterior. This is another picture of the peduncles, and you can see in the midline here the nodule of the vermis, and this is the folliculus, and this is the parafolliculus, part of the folliculonodular loop, which are separated from the rest of the cerebellum by the posterolateral fissure. And here, this is the cerebellar tonsil, as we mentioned, on the inferior surface of the cerebellum. The detailed subdivisions of the cerebellum is not required from you. There are so many classification of the sublobular structures of the cerebellum, and we just will escape to this picture, which represents the unfolded photo of the cerebellum. And remember that the lingula is the most anterior part of the superior vermis, and the nodule is the most anterior part of the vermis on the inferior surface, because this is the anterior end of the inferior surface, and this represents the anterior end of the superior surface. Okay, so the nodule represents the most anterior end of the inferior vermis, and then more posterior we have a structure called uvula, and more posterior we have a structure called pyramus, and then tuber, forium, and the names of these parts or these parts of the inferior vermis are not required from you. Just remember the lingula and the nodule. And here is another photo of the superior surface or superior view of the cerebellum. And on the left side, this is the inferior view of the cerebellum. So here, this is the primary fissure, separates between the anterior and posterior loops. And on the other photo, we have the folliculonodular loop, which is separated from the rest of the cerebellum by the posterolateral fissure. And don't forget that we have another fissure here, which is called the horizontal fissure. And here is the label for different parts of the cerebellum on the superior and on the inferior surface of the cerebellum. To know the function of the cerebellum, we have to understand the histology of the cerebellum. So the cerebellum is consisting of outer gray matter and inner white matter, just like the cerebrum. The cerebrum has outer gray matter, which is the cerebral cortex, and inner white matter, which representing the axons and fibers that leaves the cerebrum to the spinal cord. So the cerebellum, the cortex of the cerebellum, is divided into three layers. But the cortex of the cerebral cortex is divided into six layers. So the layers of the cerebellar cortex from outside inside, they are called outer molecular layer, middle Purkinje cell layer, and inner granular layer. The outer molecular layer has two types of cells, stellate and basket cells. The middle Purkinje cell layer is the only inhibitory layer to all other cells. It contains only one type of cell, which is called Purkinje cell. And the inner granular layer, it also contains two G cells, which are granule and Golgi cells. Granule cells are the only excitatory cells to all other cells. After the cortex, we come into the medulla or the medullary center, which includes the white matter of the cerebellum, and then we come again to the deep cerebellar nuclei. This picture representing the cortex or the cerebellar cortex, as you can see, this is the outer molecular layer. This is the middle Purkinje cell layer. This is the most important cell layer in the cerebellum. And then the inner granular cell layer. And here is the white matter of the cerebellum. So as you know, the white matter is consisting of axons of the cells. These axons of the cerebellum are of three types: either Mossi fibers, climbing fibers, or Purkinje cell axons. We have two afferent fibers and one efferent fibers. The two afferent fibers are Mossi fibers and the climbing fibers. And Purkinje cell gives the only efferent fibers that leave the cerebellum. So here the blue line is representing the Mossi fibers. So the Mossi fibers, they end in indirect way. So they first activate the granular cell layer, and then they jump to the Purkinje cell layer and activate them. So we say the Mossi fibers are indirectly activate the Purkinje cell. So they go first to the granular cell layer, activate this granule cell, and then they activate the Purkinje cells. In this way, they are indirectly activate the Purkinje cells. And we have also climbing fibers. The climbing fibers are fibers of the olivocerebellar tracts mainly. They are coming from the inferior olivary nucleus of the medulla. These fibers are directly activate the Purkinje cells. So they climb the granular cell layer and reach the Purkinje cell layer and directly activate them. So we call the olivocerebellar tracts climbing fibers. They are afferent, like Mossi fibers are afferent to the cerebellum. We have only efferent fibers that leave the cerebellum are called axons of Purkinje cells. So the Purkinje cells here in the middle layer of the cerebellum, these cells are representing the Purkinje cells. The axons of these Purkinje cells are leaving the cerebellum in the white matter to reach the deep cerebellar nuclei. From the deep cerebellar nuclei, the axons leave the cerebellum to end in the brainstem or thalamus or spinal cord or above in the cerebral cortex. So the axons of Purkinje cells are first activate the deep cerebellar nuclei, and the deep cerebellar nuclei are giving their efferents to different structures, to the brainstem or to the spinal cord or to the thalamus or to the cerebral cortex above. And this is very important in the cerebellar function, as we will mention in the next slide. We divide the cerebellum into archi cerebellum, or what's called vestibulo cerebellum, and ballo cerebellum, or spino cerebellum, and finally neo cerebellum, or cerebro cerebellum. The name of each part gives hint about the function. So if we say a vestibulo cerebellum, so this part of the cerebellum is concerned with balance control, because it's connected to the vestibular apparatus of the inner ear. If we say spinocerebellum, so this part is connected to the spinal cord, and it has a role in regulation of muscle tones. And if we call cerebrocerebellum, so this is the higher function of the cerebellum, which is connected to the cerebral cortex, and the function is related to the cerebral cortex. So we will see first the archi cerebellum, or the vestibulo cerebellum. First of all, we have to know the parts of the vestibulo cerebellum. If you remember, the most anterior part of the superior vermis is called lingula. And the whole folliculonodular loop, which is separated from the cerebellum through the posterolateral fissure, these two structures are forming the vestibulo cerebellum, or the archi cerebellum. So the function of this part is to control the balance. How it controls the balance? It receives afferent fibers from the vestibular apparatus of the inner ear, utricle and saccule inside the inner ear, through the vestibulocerebellar tracts. You know, we have a vestibulocerebellar tracts from the inner ear to the cerebellum. These tracts are coming directly from the vestibular ganglia or from the vestibular nuclei. And you know that the only efferent fibers that leave the cerebellum are through the axons of Purkinje cells. So all these tracts, which are vestibulocerebellar tracts, has to come to the Purkinje cell to activate them, and then the Purkinje cell will give efferent fibers to the structure which is regulating the balance. So the Purkinje fibers of the folliculonodular loop gives inhibitory axons to the vestibular nuclei again, to the ipsilateral vestibular nuclei. So the right gives to the right and the left gives to the left. These vestibular nuclei gives rise to vestibulospinal tract. You may know that the vestibulospinal tract control the anti-gravity or the extensor muscles more than flexor muscles. And also vestibulo-ocular fibers. These vestibulo-ocular fibers are responsible for what's called vestibulo-ocular reflex, which is moving of your eye in the direction of moving your vestibular apparatus inside your ear. So if you move your head to the right, so that you move your inner ear to the right side, and then your right eye and your left eye also are moving to the same direction with that of your head, and this is called vestibulo-ocular reflex. And also these vestibular nuclei gives efferent fibers to the vestibulocerebellar tracts and finally to the cortex in the vestibulocortical fibers. So the idea is that all afferent are coming from the folliculonodular loop and the lingula. These fibers, the afferent fibers to this loop are coming from the vestibular nuclei or vestibular ganglia directly from the same side. And then they have to activate Purkinje cells. And from Purkinje cells, the efferent fibers are going back to the vestibular nuclei. And from the vestibular nuclei, the efferent fibers are coming to the vestibulospinal tract down to the spinal cord to activate the anti-gravity muscles and to the eye in the vestibulo-ocular fibers to be responsible for the vestibulo-ocular reflex, or to the cerebellum again to close the circuit, and above to the cerebral cortex to the vestibulocortical fibers. Now we will discuss the spinocerebellum. So the spinocerebellum is consisting of the anterior loop with the midline vermis, which is connected to the vestigial nucleus, and the surrounding paravermis with the globose and emboliform nuclei, which are interconnected to the paravermis as we mentioned before. So we have to divide the spinocerebellum in function into two different parts, vermal zone and the paravermal zone. So the vermal zone of the spinocerebellum is controlling the axial muscles, and the paravermal zone is controlling the distal limb muscles. As we mentioned before, the vermis, which is connected to the vestigial nucleus, is controlling the muscles that near to the trunk. And the paravermal region is controlling the distal limb muscles of the upper or the lower limb. They are interconnected with the globose and emboliform. So how the vermal region is controlling the muscle tone of the axial and proximal limb muscles? The Purkinje fibers of each part of the vermis project their fibers to the vestigial nuclei, because it is connected to the vestigial nuclei. And the afferent fibers coming from the ventral and dorsal spinocerebellar tracts. These tracts, as you may know, controls the unconscious muscle tone that are coming from the deep structures of the muscle and the tendons of the muscle. And these fibers are coming from the spinal cord to the cerebellum. When they reach the cerebellum, they end in the vestigial nucleus, because this is the nucleus which is connected to the vermal region. From the vestigial nucleus, fibers are coming bilaterally to the medial motor system, because the medial motor system controls the axial and proximal limb muscles. What are the tracts that control the medial motor system? You know that we have the anterior corticospinal tracts. The anterior corticospinal tracts coming from a motor area 4 to the ipsilateral and contralateral nuclei of the thalamus, especially the ventrolateral nucleus of the thalamus. And then these nucleus of the thalamus are giving fibers to the trunk area in the motor area 4. This is the main tract that controls the medial motor system, the anterior corticospinal tract. And the whole tract is called cerebellovestigiothalamocorticospinal fibers. Cerebellu because they are coming from the cerebellum to the vestigial nucleus, and then from the vestigial nucleus, the fibers are projecting to the thalamus, to the ventrolateral nucleus of the thalamus, and then from the thalamus to the cerebral cortex, motor area 4, which controls the axial muscles, and then the fibers are coming or projecting downward to the spinal cord, to the anterior horn cells. This is the anterior corticospinal. We have another fibers which are called vestibulospinal. So vestigio, because it's coming from the vestigial nucleus that is connected with the vermis. And these fibers are projecting to the vestibular nuclei, and then from the vestibular nuclei to the spinal cord, ipsilaterally and contralaterally. And also, the lateral motor, the medial motor system is controlled through the reticulospinal tracts. So from vestigial nucleus, they are sending fibers to the reticular fibers or the reticular formations of the brainstem, ipsilateral and contralateral reticular formation, and then the reticulospinal tracts downward is projecting to the spinal cord. So the idea that is the idea of the spinocerebellum, of the vermal zone of the spinocerebellum, is that fibers are coming, the afferent fibers are coming from the ventral dorsal spinocerebellum, and also from the olivocerebellar and cuneocerebellar tracts. These fibers are ending in the vestigial nucleus of the cerebellum in the vermal region. And from the vestigial nucleus, they are giving excitatory fibers to the medial motor system. The medial motor system that controls the midline structures are coming from the vestibulospinal or the vestigioreticulospinal through the reticular formation or from the anterior corticospinal tracts. What about the spinocerebellum that is connected to the paravermal region of the cerebellum? So the function of this part is to control and regulate the muscle tone, mainly of the flexor muscles, and also control and regulate the voluntary movements of the distal upper and lower limb muscles. To have this function, it has to receive afferent fibers like those of the vermal region of the spinocerebellum from the anterior and posterior spinocerebellar tracts, and also from the olivocerebellar and cuneocerebellar tracts. So these tracts are giving the unconscious proprioception impulse to the nuclei of the paravermal region. What are the nuclei that are connected to the paravermal region? They are called interposed nuclei, the globose and emboliform. When they reach these nuclei, the efferents that coming from these interposed nuclei are controlling the lateral motor system. If you remember, the lateral motor system is controlling the lateral corticospinal tracts of the pyramidal tract fibers. So they are projecting to the contralateral ventrolateral nucleus of the thalamus, and then from this nucleus of the thalamus, the fibers are projecting to a motor area 4 that controls the distal limb muscles. So the whole pathway is called cerebellum-globose-emboliform thalamocorticospinal pathway. And also, it has a very important connection with the red nucleus of the midbrain, because the red nucleus of the midbrain is concerned with the distal muscles, control and regulate the muscle tone of the mainly flexors of the distal muscles. So the whole pathway is cerebellum-globose-emboliform rubrospinal pathway. Rubro here represented by the red nucleus inside the midbrain. So the fibers are coming from the interposed nuclei to the red nucleus of the opposite side, and then from the red nucleus, rubrospinal tracts are projecting to the anterior horn cells that control the proximal muscles of the limb, mainly flexors. Lastly, we have the neocerebellum or the cerebrocerebellum. This part is represented by the two cerebellar hemispheres, the rest of the two cerebellar hemispheres, and this part is connected to the dentate nucleus, as we mentioned before, this is a dentate nucleus, which is a bag of crumbled nuclei in the lateral part of inside the cerebellar substance, which is present more lateral in position. So the neocerebellum has a great function in control voluntary movement and planning of movements, even before the execution of motor activity. As we mentioned before, we have two structures that do this function, which is the cerebellum and the basal nuclei. These two structures, the main function of these two structures are the anticipation of movement. So they anticipate the movement before it happens and put the body and put the limb muscles and the whole muscles of the body in a way that it will be easy for the execution of motor movement. And also it has a great role in regulation of the force and distance of movement and the time of the movement. And also it has a major role in learning new complex movements, like learning, for example, football, gaming, and these movements that requires very skilled movement. So the afferent fibers, which are coming to the dentate nucleus, are coming from the cerebral cortex. So the fibers are coming from the cerebral cortex and they go to the pons. And then from the pons, they are crossing to the opposite side through the middle cerebellar peduncle to reach the dentate nucleus of the other side. This course is called cortico-ponto-cerebellar pathway. So from the cortex, cerebral cortex, the fibers are coming to the pons. And from the pons, they are crossing to the opposite side through the middle cerebellar peduncle to reach the opposite dentate nucleus. And then from the dentate nucleus, fibers are projecting to the thalamus or in the spinal cord, to the contralateral rib nucleus first. And then, so they are coming back to the rib nucleus above in the midbrane. And then from the rib nucleus to the ventral nucleus of the thalamus. And then from the thalamus down to the spinal cord. The whole pathway is called cortico-ponto-cerebro, and then from the cerebellum, dentato-rubro-thalamo-cortico-spinal pathway. It is a very long nerve. It's a very long course, because the course of these fibers are very long. So it begins from the cerebral cortex, mainly from motor area 4 and premotor area 6, and then reach the pons. Then the fibers from the pons cross to the dentate nucleus of the other side. The fibers from the pons cross to the opposite dentate nucleus through the middle cerebellar peduncle, and then from the dentate nucleus of the cerebellum to the rib nucleus, which is situated in the midbrain. It has to cross to the other side through the superior cerebellar peduncle. And then from the rib nucleus, the fibers are projecting to the anterior nucleus of the thalamus. And then from the ventral nucleus of the thalamus, the fibers are projecting downward to the spinal cord and execute the motor activity. Okay. So just to summarize the main functional subdivisions of the cerebellum, this is the vestibular, this is the folliculonodular loop. The folliculonodular loop is connected to the vestibular nuclei and vestibular ganglion, and then the fibers are projecting to the vestibular nuclei again and controlling the balance and eye movement. You have the spinocerebellum. You have the midline, which is the vermal region of the spinocerebellum, that is connected with the vestigial nucleus, and the vestigial nucleus is connected or is controlling the medial motor system, and the interposed nuclei, which are located in the paravermal region of the cerebellum, are connected or controlling the lateral descending motor system. and they are controlling the distal muscles of limbs, and you have also the dentate nucleus, which is connected with the cerebrum, and then the whole pathway is controlling the motor planning and learning new skills, as we mentioned before, and this is called cerebrocerebellum. You may be interested to know the fibers that enter and leave the cerebellum through the peduncles, and the these tracts are extensively been discussed before in the section of the spinal cord. So for example, the fibers that leave the spinal cord, the fibers that comes to the cerebellum through the superior cerebellar peduncle are coming from the ventral spinocerebellar tract and trigeminocerebellar tract, from the mesencephalic nucleus, and from the tectum of the midbrain through the tectocerebellar tracts. And the fibers that leaving that are leaving the cerebellum through the superior cerebellar peduncle are the cerebellorubral fibers, which is the pathway that we have mentioned before, globose empoliform rubral, and also the cerebellothalamic fibers through the dentate nucleus to the thalamus, and the cerebelloreticular fibers from the vestigial nucleus to the reticular formation on both sides. And the fibers that enters the middle cerebellar peduncle, the long course, the very long course that we have mentioned in connection with the cerebrum, which is called corticobontocerebellum, to the dentate nucleus of the cerebellum. And the fibers that enter the inferior cerebellar peduncles, the fibers are coming from the posterior spinocerebellar tract, cuneocerebellar tracts, olivocerebellar tracts from the inferior olive of the medulla, reticulocerebellar from the reticular formation, vestibulocerebellar from the vestibular nuclei, trigeminocerebellar from the trigeminal nuclei, and anterior external arcuate fibers. The fibers that are leaving the cerebellum through the inferior cerebellar peduncles are those in bold in the afferent fibers. They are coming again to leave the cerebellum as efferent fibers. They are cerebellooliveri to the inferior olive, cerebellovestibular, and then cerebelloreticular. The blood supply of the cerebellum is very important, and this blood supply will be discussed in details with the section of blood supply of the brain. Just to know that the cerebellum is supplied by a superior cerebellar artery, which is a branch of the basilar artery, and the anterior inferior cerebellar artery, which is a branch also from the basilar artery, and the posterior inferior cerebellar artery, which is a branch from the vertebral artery. So the cerebellum is richly supplied by a basilar artery and only one artery from the vertebral artery. Just to compare between the cerebellum and the basal nuclei in controlling motor activity, you have this table here, which compare between the cerebellum and the basal nuclei. So the cerebellum receives the corticobontocerebellar fibers from the contralateral cerebellar hemisphere, while the basal nuclei receives the corticostriate fibers from the ipsilateral cerebellar cortex. So the cerebellum is connected to the opposite cerebellum, opposite cerebral hemisphere, while the basal nuclei is connected ipsilaterally to the cerebral cortex. And the fibers project from the cerebellum to the ventrolateral nucleus on the contralateral side of the thalamus, and then project directly to area 4 and 6, while the fibers of the basal nuclei projects to the ventroanterior nucleus of the thalamus to the ipsilateral side, and controls the supplementary motor area then to area 4 and 6. So finally, the cerebellum is controlling the movement on the ipsilateral half of the body because it has a double crossing, as it is connected to the contralateral side of the cerebellum, then it crosses to the opposite side of the thalamus, while the basal nuclei controls the movement on the contralateral half of the body because it has only one crossing, or it is connected to the ipsilateral cerebral hemisphere. But remember that the fibers are crossing again in the pyramid of the medulla oblongata, so that the right cerebral cortex is controlling the left side of the body, and also the right basal nuclei are controlling the left side of the body, while the right cerebellar hemisphere is controlling the right side of the body, and vice versa. Okay, the lesion of the cerebellum is called ataxia. So ataxia is defined as incoordination of movements. And you will discuss this condition in details in pathology. But if you want to know about symptoms of ataxia, they are all included here. The ataxia may be produced from a lesion of the baleo cerebellar or the baleo cerebellum region, which is the spinocerebellum, or the neocerebellar lesion, which is the cerebrocerebellum. And if the lesion is in the spinal part of the cerebellum, the manifestations will be more on the gait, and you can test this by what's called heel to chin test. So if you ask the patient to put his heel on top of his chin of the tibia on the leg, and then move the chin of the tibia, the chin of the heel, and then move his heel over the chin of the tibia, if he has a baleocerebellar region, he cannot do this function. And the neocerebellar lesion is more manifested by hypotonia and ataxia of upper limbs, and also tremors in the distal parts of the hands. And this could be tested by finger to nose test. If you ask the patient to move his finger to touch his nose, he cannot do this function if he has a neocerebellar lesion. And here you can see these manifestations and tests that the doctor or the neuro subject are telling the patient to do to discover in which part of the cerebellum is lesioned. Finally, we have a condition known as cerebellar medulloblastoma, and this condition affects the axial, the trunk, and the axial muscles that controls the posture. So the patient is represented with truncal ataxia, and he cannot stand unless he fix his body with his limb on a table or an edge of the bed. And this occurs more in children, and this child, she is not able to stand unsupported, and this is called cerebellar medulloblastoma, which is a tumor affecting the part of vermis. Now we have reached to the end of our lecture. I hope you were interested in the cerebellum function and the role of cerebellum in regulating the balance and coordination of different movement, and the planning and learning new skills. It's very important to know the function of the cerebellum. Thank you very much, and see you inshallah in next lecture.